So I was surprised when you said earlier that there aren't enough people that are thinking about the foundational issues, because to me, there's an overproduction of these people. And in my estimation, from what I see from being on the inside, formerly on the inside of academia, and also from speaking to people who are on the inside and just seeing this whole trend, it seems like we're producing many, many physicists or people with physics skill sets and people with mathematics skill sets, and then they don't have a place to go. So I'll read a recent tweet. Someone said, "Me, after finishing my PhD, surely I'll be able to find some jobs in my field. No. Next. Okay, how about getting access to the online journals so I can continue my research? No. Okay, at least I can still upload my work onto free online preprint repositories, right? Also, no." And then you even commented, "This really shouldn't happen. I feel we need to create a scientific underground." So do you also see that there's an overproduction of scientists, or you don't see that? And I want to know more about this scientific underground as well.
So the overproduction of PhDs, like, this is a long-standing problem that has been discussed forward and backward. And the, like, I think most people who I've talked to about this agree that this is driven by the need for cheap researchers. So a lot of this bringing in grants depends on how quickly you can churn out papers. And the more students and the more young postdocs you have that you can put on cheap positions, the better. And so you see this in a lot of institutions, and I've seen this with my own eyes. Actually, I was one of them, is that you hire students, young postdocs, you put them on these super cheap jobs, they produce their three papers, you kick them out. But for most of them, there are no positions to land on. You know, there are just not sufficiently many jobs. And the reason this doesn't change is that the people higher up in the hierarchy, like the professors, especially the younger ones, they need these people to produce all these papers. And I think this is why this isn't changing. I don't really know what to do about it. I'm just telling you, I think that that's what's going on. I remember this tweet, and the reason I thought it was interesting is that this is a problem I've seen with a lot of people who I know who've left academia, mostly voluntarily, and they went on to take some other job, you know, something that would feed the family more reliably, basically. But they don't lose their interest from one day to the next. You know, in many cases, they have unfinished research, or maybe they have some other research things that I want to work on. And, you know, they do it on the weekend, you know, out of passion. Uh-huh. But then they have the problem that since they're no longer affiliated with some institution, some journals won't even accept their submissions, which I think is just totally crazy. Like, why do you need a university affiliation or something to submit a paper to a journal that's supposed to be peer-reviewed? That doesn't make any sense. And you can also ask, like, if they want to go to a conference, you know, they can't apply for any funding or something because they don't have this affiliation. And then there is also the community problem, right? You're no longer really tied into the community, and, you know, you fall a little bit out of touch. And as I said earlier, like, just looking at the numbers, I have the exact numbers on top of my head, but I'm pretty sure, like, the majority of people who have something to do with academia at some point leave eventually. So, and this is why I had this tweet about the scientific underground, which is loosely speaking how I've become to call it. You know, it's all those people who want to do this research work, but who are not affiliated with a university or some other research institute. But so what do they do? You know, how do they organize themselves? Why can these people not apply for travel grants? Why can they not submit papers? That doesn't make any sense.
Right, right.
And so this seems to me, if I had more time, maybe I would do something about it. You know, it can't be so difficult to fund some sort of community where people can get together and try to find a way to solve this problem. But yeah, I think it's a growing problem. You know, I see more and more people in that position who are frustrated about it because they've written a paper And let me be clear, like, I'm not talking about some, you know, some people with their revolutionary new quantum mechanics. You know, it's typically, it is like super technical stuff, some sort of data analysis or, you know, something that came out of their PhD.
It's not a printout from ChatGPT.
Right. Or actually, this tweet from the guy, he actually, what he wanted to do was he wanted to post his PhD thesis on the archive. And, you know, he's already got his PhD, right? So how bad can it be? Why can't they just let him post his PhD thesis? Like, this is, like, crazy. And, of course, I mean, I understand, like, the archive is, they have a lot of problems with whether they find people to moderate the papers. And so there are things going wrong there. But I have even less understanding for this when it comes to journalists who are actually making money with this kind of stuff.
Yeah, I'm extremely interested in independent scholarship. So while the Theories of Everything audience has a large amount of academic researchers who watch the show, I want to contribute to academia in a way that's outside the academy. And I see this as a large gap in a way that supplements the academy rather than opposes it or overthrows it or what have you. I see the universities as doing something necessary, and I'd like to help that and see where its problems are and fill in the gaps. But I'm not entirely sure how to do that. So anytime, Sabina, when you have ideas or anyone from the audience, and just feel free to contact me. I want to bring up something you said I want to bring up a critique that I've heard thrown at you that I think is unfair. And then I want to bring up something that I think you said that was unfair in one of your videos.
Okay.
So a critique that is thrown at you, which is something you just said, which is, look, you outlined a problem, then you said, I don't know how to solve it. And some people are like, look, she's just bringing up problems. What are the solutions? I think that's quite unfair. In the scientific method, your propositions just live and die on their own as to whether they're true or false. You can state a problem without knowing a solution. So in the early 2000s, when Lee Smolin came out with his book against string theory, the string theorists criticized him. They were saying, look, Lee, you're just trying to promote your own theory, namely loop quantum gravity. Peter Voigt at the same time had his own criticisms of string theory. And then the string theorists came to him and said, look, well, you're just criticizing without putting up any alternative. Put up or shut up is something that people say. I don't think that's fair. I think a criticism should stand on its own. It's not whether there's a solution attached to it. Then something that you said that I think was unfair was Peter Voigt now does have his own alternative. And I remember you in a video, and I don't recall the video, so I apologize, but you were lamenting some science problem, and then you were saying the only people who are talking about this are me, Peter Voigt, and Eric. And those two have their own solutions that they're trying to peddle. And I was like, okay, but that doesn't minimize what they're saying. Now, that was an offhanded remark in just a single video, and you have thousands of videos. And so it's unfair of me to even bring this up, because if you examine anyone who has such a wealth of content, you'll find different sentences here and there to nitpick. So I don't want this to be that I'm ill-natured or perverse in my carping, but I'd just like you to expand on that, to tell me what your thoughts are on what I just said.
I can totally tell you what. So first of all, it was mostly meant as a joke. So I know both Eric and Peter Voigt. And what I had in mind when I said this was that we had a meeting, and this is a really long story, which was Eric Weinstein's idea. And we all sat together with some other people, including Garrett Lacey, and it was about Theories of Everything. Like, officially, kind of, the topic was my book, my book Lost in Math, in which I explained how you should not go about theory development. Right. So my entire point is, like, you have to have a concrete problem to solve. Like, you have to try to find an inconsistency to resolve, and then you have to try to find a way to experimentally test it. So this is like of, you know, my summary. And of course, you can disagree with that and maybe have a better way to do it. But so the irony of the whole thing was that I ended up with these people who do exactly what I said we should not do, right? Like, so Garrett Lacey, Eric Weinstein, Peter Voigt. This is exactly the same thing that they also do. and so I find this, you know, it has a certain irony to it. You know, I don't, you know, I understand that.
When was this meeting?
Jesus, it must have been before Corona. Sorry, this is how the Germans call it, COVID. I don't know why the Germans stuck with this, calling it Corona. I think it's funny because, you know, I've tried to get people to understand my criticism, and even the ones who are sympathetic to it don't want to actually use it. So I'm like, okay, all right, you know, whatever. So what can I say?
About when you said that you have investigated climate change, and then you've talked to climate scientists, and you've seen how different, it's called Gelman amnesia, I believe, where you see, actually, no, it's not Gelman amnesia in this case. It's the opposite, where you've noticed how false scientific reporting can be in physics, but then you've actually investigated it in other domains. And so now you're just not a fan of not only science journalism, but maybe scientists. What if someone's like, okay, that's similar to a claim of racism, where you've interacted with a few women or a few minorities or a few of whatever, or of white people, and then you've had bad experiences, and so you generalize to all white people or to all males or what have you, rather than keeping the claims specific and not abstracting away. So how do you disembroil between critiquing science as a whole or scientists as a whole versus just the specific claims that you've investigated?
I think we're conflating two different things now. So the one is my trust issue, where I say I don't trust scientists because of what I've said, and the other is what's wrong with science overall. So I think when it comes to my trust issue, you know, it's just a matter of I want to see proof. So I'm not saying necessarily there is something wrong in these other disciplines. But I want to know reason why I should trust those people. So I think that the comparison is not quite adequate. It's actually, I'm exactly trying to not fall the Gelman amnesia issue in saying, okay, but it's only a problem, this particular discipline, because I think it's a systemic problem. So I have no reason to assume that it doesn't also exist elsewhere. So when it comes to the issue with science overall, I'm more relying on data, which I talked about in a recent video. I've for a long time, I think this is also some connections that go back to Eric Weinstein, who I've known for a long time. So it's a really long story.
Sure.
In any case, so I've been very interested in the economic impact of technology. And there's a long background story about how progress seems to be slowing down, which is what Tyler Cowen, I think is his name. I think that's how it's pronounced.
Yes. Right.
Yeah. So,
The Economist.
Yeah. Other people have been working on for a long time, you know, how do you actually quantify the impact of technology on our society? And at least my understanding of what they found is that progress has been slowing down. And there are a couple of different ways to look at it. So Tyler himself seems to have recently said there seem to be some indications that the trend has been reversing, and then other people have disagreed with it. So, you know, it's its own research field.
I see.
And there have also, I've been very interested in what's called scientometrics or bibliometric analysis of what can you squeeze out of the scientific literature. And I actually had a research project on this. So this is another long story that I don't want to get into.
You don't want to get into, or you want to?
No, I don't want to get into it, because then we'll still be talking at, you know, tomorrow morning.
Okay.
So I know a little bit about bibliometric analysis, and I've worked on this myself. And there have been numerous papers saying that there are indications that scientific progress is actually slowing down. And you can always ask, like, exactly how did they measure scientific progress? And everyone does it in their own way. Like, this is an entire art discipline, basically, where they make up new measures. And so the reason why I find it convincing is that it doesn't really matter exactly how they did it. They always found more or less the same thing, which is that scientific progress has been slowing down since the 1960s, 1970s.
As you know, on Theories of Everything, we delve into some of the most reality-spiraling concepts, from theoretical physics and consciousness to AI and emerging technologies. To stay informed in an ever-evolving landscape, I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of TOE, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/TOE, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.